All right, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I want to say thank you to Team Eritrea. As we head to China, we have our athlete, Shannon Abeda. Shannon representing Eritrea for the second time in the Senior Olympics and I believe one time in the Youth Olympics. So with him, we have Coach Ryley, Remme, and Emilio, Ficaccio. Is that how you say it? Did I say it right?
Yeah, that's right.
Well, first, I'd like to thank you guys for being with us, and I just want to give you guys the mic to introduce yourselves. You can start off with Ryley.
Sure. Yeah, I'm Shannon's coach, former teammate. You know, and so I think we have a bit of a history as competitors and all that. So, you know, a bit of an understanding and kind of relatable to you know what he's doing, and we also shared his last coach, Helmut Spiegel, was also my last coach. So I, you know, it's easy to take. Easy to relate to that, and what Shannon needs in a coach, and excited to be working with him.
Well, that's great. And Emilio, in what capacity are you helping Shannon?
Hi. Yeah. So as we already said, my name's Emilio. My position on the team is technically CLO, so the COVID liaison officer. Basically, I'm going to be doing anything and everything to make sure that we all safely get to Beijing and stay safe throughout the duration of the games and make sure we're following all the proper COVID protocols that are required so that we can get through it safely. Me and Shannon have been really good friends for a while now. I think that, you know, one thing that Shannon mentioned is how important it is to have a good support team around him during these games. So me and him have been talking lots, and that's what we are trying to put a lot of focus on is making sure that he feels supported and good to go for go time.
Very good. And so now we go to the athletes and we talk to Shannon. Shannon, the mic is yours. First, I want to say it's a pleasure having you here. We're excited about your second opportunity in the big Olympics. So talk a little bit about you know, I know everybody knows who you are, but introduce yourself and talk a little bit about what you are planning for the upcoming Olympics taking place in China. And what differences do you think you can make from the ones that you've been to in Pyongyang in the past, and then also the youth one in Innsbruck.
All right, I'll reintroduce myself. My name is Shannon-Ogbnai Abeda. I am Eritrea's first Winter Olympic athlete, and I'm en route to Beijing 2022. It's honestly, I never really thought that I'd be coming back again for another Olympic cycle because I had stepped away from ski racing to do another sport. But in my time off, I realized this was something I wanted to give a shot again. It's been a bit difficult just given the COVID situation and, you know, lack of races and also, you know, finding the right training, but we made it happen. And I'm happy. I think building on from, you know, 2012 games, I was very young, kind of naive to how the international competition works. And I also came in thinking that I was this high and mighty person, and I pretty much got put in my place. And then from 2018, the team that I had was not well built. I did have a good coach, but the support systems were not there to enable me to perform. And I found myself doing a lot more than I should. And I think now, even though I do feel like I did a lot to get to these games, I do have a good support system, and I'm feeling very confident going into these games, knowing that I can focus more on my skiing and not have to worry about other things.
That's great to hear. And so with that, I also want to introduce myself. I know everybody knows, in the community knows a little bit about what I've been doing with sports. And so with that, I want to say not only am I representing Eritrea and the public relations capacity, but I'm also been assigned to do the chef de mission, as they call it, and chief of mission of the team. And I'm very honored to do this for Eritrea. And obviously, Shannon, I feel honored you asking me to do this, and me being accepted by the NOC was a very, very exciting opportunity for me. As you know, I'm always working towards development and building the sports programs that are taking place in Eritrea through some other projects that I've been working on. So with that said, I want to talk a little bit about, you know, in Pyongyang, you had a very pretty decent run. I mean, you actually finished 61st out of a big pool of skiers. And that's not bad for a country that does not have ice or snow. And so for me, that was an amazing result. And a lot of people are actually fascinated by that. So let's talk a little bit about your experience and what you think you can do different this year. We'll go to Shannon and then you guys can chime in on why you think we could be better this time around without going into the details of the technical aspects of what you're doing.
Yeah, you know, I going into the last games, I do have to be honest, it was very stressful for me. And, you know, mentally, I wasn't where I wanted to be. And pulling off that result I was really, really happy. But I did hold myself back a lot. I knew that walking away, that was not what I could have performed. It was a good result, but definitely there was more in the tank. And that's kind of one of the reasons why I'm back in the sport is I don't want to leave anything on the table. So, I mean, that race was pretty good. Like, the set was good. The conditions were, you know, held up. I really like the snow in China, and I'm you know, hoping that it's pretty much the same in Beijing. I think now going on to these races, I'm physically stronger. I'm at like best physical shape that I've ever been in my entire life. You know, coming from a bobsled background and then going back to skiing, a lot of that power has translated into my skiing. I'm on better equipment now. As I mentioned before, I have a better support system. And generally, I feel more happier doing what I'm doing. Leading up to the Olympics, it just became this very like monotonous routine. And I didn't find any enjoyment or passion anymore. And now being back on the hill and being able to push myself and also convince myself that I can do better is something that I think coming to these games will make me a stronger skier for sure.
That's fantastic. And so Ryley, I know the last time, I don't know if I'm mistaken, but if you looked at Shannon's record, I believe it was 10 seconds or something like that off from the people who won the actually medals. So what are chances of Shannon now possibly competing for a higher position?
I think they're good. I think comfort and familiarity with the environment, you know, and what the expectations are on, you know, of the athletes in the days leading up to the race, on the day of the race, you know, it's not like going to any old race, right? It's the Olympics. You can only experience it once every 4 years. You know, not many people get to experience multiple times. And so Shannon has, you know, an advantage there. This is his second time going through that process, which you can't really replicate anywhere. So there's a comfort in that. And in ski racing, comfort and confidence is really big. It's as big as anything almost.
It can change the momentum very quickly, right? So you don't know what could happen if the person is able to at least compete at some level of comfort.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. And it's as simple as knowing, you know, how the meal plan works. Like, how, you know, where do you get breakfast? You know, it's just finding a routine. You know, it gives you that comfort during the day. And I think that'll be a really big thing. You know, it's my first time being at the Olympics with Shannon, but you know, you can just see in working with him how, you know, comfortable he is in his preparation and understanding what he's getting himself into, which, you know, I assume wasn't so much the case for him 4 years ago. So I think that comfort will be really big.
And Emilio, I know you are more of a COVID liaison, but I'm sure you're familiar with Shannon and the skiing and all that. Yeah, just in a nutshell, with you being in the COVID liaison, what kind of role does the COVID have? I know a lot of people have been kind of sitting back and not training and not doing all those things that they're supposed to be doing, and some are not. So what do you think, how do you think the competition, the outcome of the competition will be because of COVID?
Yeah, so basically it's a whole nother layer to these Olympics that's never really been seen before. It's a lot more rules that all teams and athletes are having to deal with. You have to really make sure that you're on top of everything so you don't run into any challenges, you don't run into actually getting COVID and getting sick ahead of the games or during. So it's kind of everybody's individual responsibility to be extra careful and take all the necessary protocols to make sure that you're good and healthy. And I also think that a big part of it is COVID as a situation entirely can be very anxious for a lot of people. And there's a huge, huge role in the mental health of athletics as much as the physical health. So I think it's been very important to make sure that Shannon can take care of his mental health while he leads up towards the games. And I think that that's why it'll be a good thing to delegate the COVID protocols off to somebody else, so he can just make sure that that's taken care of and he can focus on his athletic performance.
Well, that's fantastic. And so without going into a lot, again, Shannon, you came out of retirement because when we spoke last, I mean, last Olympics, I recall, I got a clip of your video. Apparently, a lot of people didn't have access to it, but I was able to work through my network. I was able to find your performance and posted it online on social media. And amazingly, within like a day, there was like 60, 70,000 people just looking at it. So there is a big following that you have, especially within our Eritrean community, because it's something unique, something different. And this is a country, like I said, doesn't have snow. It's in Africa. And so for us, this is a unique situation to be able to represent Eritrea in a Winter Olympics. So now, with that said, what led you to come out of retirement? That's number one. Number two, you mentioned to me that there's a possibility of you further continuing in some capacity with Winter Olympics. And so we'll get to that a little bit later. But what led you to come out of retirement?
This is a little bit of a tough one emotionally for me. I guess, I walked away from ski racing because of some, external factors that were in the sport. And as well as, I lost a lot of who I was. I didn't really know who Shannon was. But in my time away, I guess I started thinking a lot about, again, what I left on the table at the last Olympics. And someone close to me, passed away during COVID at a very young age. And it made me think a lot about, my own vulnerability and where I am right now. Back then I was 24, I'm 25 now. And I didn't want to live my life with any more regret. And I think one of my biggest regrets was how I performed at the last Olympics, at least in, my view of where I was mentally. Physically, I definitely was at good shape, but I was not in the racing mindset. So I thought about it a lot. I said, is this doable? Is this really feasible? And I started skiing more just casually with a friend over COVID, just to get outdoors more. And I started finding my love for the sport again. And that's what kind of really made me decide to come back.
That's fantastic. And I think, you'd mentioned that a lot of the work that we do, obviously with us Eritrea being more into the Summer Olympics, this is a very rare occasion. There's also a lot of things that we could improve on in terms of management and other things. And I know that comes with the territory. So I know that you, Ryley and Emilio also, you are wondering how things would pan out. But now that we're going, things are falling in place. We have to understand the whole concept of management. And when you manage a team, it's always difficult. You don't know, something small can stop you from getting to your dreams. And now that we are almost there, how do you guys feel? Any of you can chime in on this, but how do you guys feel about us going to China and participating in what would be a very unique Olympics? Because obviously some countries may not be there as well. Some sports teams are not. I hear that hockey is not going to be there. So what do you guys make of that? Anyone can chime in. Emilio, Ryley, anybody can talk. Did you guys understand the question?
Yeah. I'll start. I don't know that I have too much to say on it. I think at the end of the day, it's still the Olympics. It'll be different, but you're still going to see national pride and from all the nations, and regardless of whether it's, you may not have all the hockey players there, but you're going to have whoever is there is going to be doing what they can kind of on that world stage for their countries. I think the protocols will be a little different. I'm not sure it'll be that you know, I don't think you'll see too much else that's different as far as, you know, what the athletes and the countries bring to it.
Right. I mean, like you said, at the end of the day, it is the Olympics. It's got to go on. And obviously, external factors have always been a part of the Olympics. We all know that in Montreal, I believe in 1976, that, you know, started off. And then I believe it was 1980 also in Russia, there were some issues. But things started getting better. And I think that, you know, at the end of the day, sports competition is supposed to bring people together. And I think that's why we as Eritreans, this is a unique moment for us. And so when I say this, I didn't bring it up to be controversial, but more to let the world know that here we are, a small nation with no snow, with no skiing opportunities anywhere in the country. And we're representing because Shannon truly loves his country. And I think you guys join helping out, and hopefully we have programs so we can train other Eritreans coming into skiing and growing the sport for other African countries as well. We're trying to be pioneers. Of course, I believe there's a Nigerian skier that's going to be skiing out of Switzerland. Last I checked, I know that Haiti has got a representative there. And so a couple of countries that are not very, you know, common with skiing are going to be in the Olympics. So with that said, the last thing I wanted to ask you guys was, what is your connection to Eritrea other than Shannon? Do you know much about Eritrea? So you tell our communities what you both think of Eritrea and what you know about, a little bit about Eritrean community and culture or whatever.
Yeah, I'll touch on that. So as I've gotten to know Shannon, I've been becoming more and more familiar with Eritrean and the Eritrean community. And I just see how incredible of an opportunity this is, as you said, for the future generations that are coming. As Shannon is the first Eritrean Winter Olympic athlete for the country. And as you touched on being pioneers, I think it's just an incredible opportunity for, you know, people like me being from Canada to learn more and more about Eritrea and the Eritrean culture. And I'm excited to continue learning as we work towards the games and what we're doing here.
Fantastic. How about you, Ryley? Talk a little bit about what you know.
Yeah, I think, you know, to be honest, I didn't know too much. Shannon really, you know, it was the first Eritrean that I've met, you know, and some of it's just, you know, learning some of the, you know, traditional dishes and food, you know.
So what is what's your favorite food in Jeddah? You like that traditional hand in Jeddah
food? Honestly, he hasn't made me any, so we'll
Shannon, you're in trouble, buddy.
Yeah, he's gonna have to make me some. He's been teasing me, telling me about some of them, but we'll have to make sure I get some now. But no, you know, it's really cool to be a part of, you know, Shannon, like Emilio said, being the first Winter Olympian from the country, and you're already seeing, you know, the interest behind it and other athletes kind of following in his path. So, you know, it's just been pretty special to be a part of that.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I know Shannon, with what Ryley just said, other athletes, we recently this weekend got word about a young man who contacted you, and I think I've kind of been following him a little bit too, but he's really interested in following in your footsteps. And I think he might have a replacement coming into the future Olympics. And obviously we're going to try to work also try to build other Winter Olympians once this one is over. So talk a little bit about what the young man has said to you. I thought that was very interesting, the text or a tweet or whatever he sent you.
Yeah, so this, I noticed that there was this account following me called Adam Ski with an Eritrean flag, and I thought maybe it's just, you know, a burner account, you know, impersonating me. They had no pictures or anything. And then a few days, last weekend, I look, and there was pictures of an Eritrean on cross-country skis. And I immediately sent him a message, and I said, please send me an email right now. I need to know your story. I need to know what's going on. And his follow-up was emails that he had actually sent to the NOC to get his passport, to get a FIS registration. And he had also been, you know, silently in the background watching my results. And he showed me my entire score sheet. He was calculating my points for qualification, even, you know, back in April of 2021. which was, you know, shocking for me to see that someone was, you know, watching. And I did end up talking to him briefly over the last few days through voice memos. And one of the things he said is my trip back to Eritrea in 2019 inspired him, because I had mentioned in the media that there's a very strong cycling team and athletics, and those could easily translate into, you know, a leg dominant sport like bobsled, for example, and, you know, cross-country skiing. And he said, and he lives in Germany, and he said, I can do cross-country skiing. Like, it's not too far for me to do it. So I'm going to do everything I can. He has self-appointed me as the sport director. I have no idea about cross-country skiing. I'm going to do whatever I can to make sure that he is there. And, you know, if I'm not there for 2026, so, you know, my goal is to have a bobsled team. If that's not possible, at least I know Eritrea in some capacity will have representation, and I will be a part of it.
That's fantastic. And so I think we're going to probably wrap it up around that. I think that was a good ending. Ryley, I hope that you will also be able to help in some capacity going forward with Shannon, trying to build. We're trying to pass on the torch to the next generation. We're doing the same with a lot of other sports, soccer, basketball, and other things. And this is an incredible opportunity for all of us to kind of go into the winter sports. You know, winter sports are always not very popular, but I think this is an opportunity that could open up to a lot of young people, like Emilio said. With that said, I'll give you guys the mic for one last round, if anything you want to say. But before that, I wanted to say that, you know, the fact that we are being represented in Beijing this time around is a huge deal. I want you guys to know that, because a lot of people are today going to find out, well, this is going to probably air this weekend. They're going to find out for the first time. We haven't even touched the surface yet. So it's going to start going viral. I know a lot of people are excited about this. So last words, and we can wrap it up. We can start off with Emilio. Go ahead, Emilio.
Yeah, thank you. So I just wanted to say that I think it's an absolutely incredible opportunity what we're doing here. I see the way that Shannon is working every single day. And as a team, we're going to do everything we can to make sure that we're representing the country as positively as we possibly can. And I'm super excited for the outcome and the future for Eritrea.
Thank you. Ryley?
Yeah, I mean, like Shannon said, you know, he's in the best shape of his life. You know, I've seen where he's come from. We started skiing together as teammates originally, you know, 5 years ago. And, you know, so just to see where he's come and grown, and he's in the, you know, the best shape of his life, and putting in the training and the hard work. And I'm just excited, you know, for him to be able to put that on display in a couple of weeks, and for everyone to be able to see that.
Well, thank you, Coach. And Shannon, last words.
You know, I'm excited. You know, as I mentioned before, I think back in, you know, October, I didn't really think this was going to happen. And, you know, with COVID and everything, I'm still a little bit in shock that I pulled this off. And it was tough. Like, there was lots of things that were going wrong, and it seemed like everything was telling me not to do this, and I still kept pushing, and I'm here. So I just want to soak up every moment while I'm there and enjoy myself and, you know, have a good time.
You are persistent like the camel. That's the Eritrean logo. You know, the camel keeps marching, you know, the dogs barking, you know, that kind of thing. So with that said, I will also end it with saying goodbye to everybody. I want to thank you, Shannon. I want to thank you, Ryley, Emilio, not only for being part of the team and the delegation, but for allowing me and trusting in me to be the chief of mission for the team. Not only that, but also we're going to be doing a lot of PR work. I know this is going to be a big story in the Olympics. We're already getting a lot of media attention. So with that said, I want to say thank you. See you guys soon. This will be the message that we're going to be sending to our community. Again, thank you very much.